in some ways, one of the only things that was transferred from Colin Kentwell's concept model of Luke's land speeder to actually Luke's land speeder was almost the kind of the color temperature. But you can see that they don't have anything to do with each other. Part of the reason was that they wanted it to have a little car on the inside so we could actually drive it, whereas the concept model isn't a model that you would put a little wheel, you know, an English three-wheel car underneath of it and drive it around in the desert. So they built that very low version of it so they could hide a little automobile in the inside of there. Also, there wasn't a good way to have a group of people in that, whereas in Luke's you could have he and Ben Kenobi and then R2-D2 on the back and C-3PO. It was like they all got jammed into the thing. In that original concept, you couldn't see the actors. And of course, the actors are the big deal in the film. You know, if you don't have them, your models would just be, no one would go see a movie that just had models in it, you know, I don't think. Look at the Millennium Falcon. The concept model wasn't anything like it became.
The Falcon started out as the blockade runner. We finished it, photographed, sent it to England because they had a bunch of carpenters, like 300-400 carpenters waiting for it. And the associate producer, Jim Nelson's like flipping out. And there was a show on TV at the time in England called Space 1999. And the word was that we copied that ship. Well, I'd never seen the show, and it was coincidence that they were both long and slender, and they had an engine cluster here, and they had a cockpit up here. But that's it. And George wanted something different.
He said something, well, make the ship kind of like a hamburger, you know, the bun on, I'm sorry, and the meat in the middle, like that. And then another word that he said was something like, well, I want it like a hamburger, but how about when it actually flies, it flies like a sunfish, so it's a long, narrow thing, and that's why it had that rotating cockpit. For some reason, that idea died real quickly.
There was a mad rush. We had to get this thing done in like a few weeks so that we wouldn't keep these people waiting in England. And we had everybody in this, well, the camera guys dropped their work, they were making parts, and then they brought it to us, and we just put stuff on it, but in a way that Joe Johnson wanted, and it had to look mechanical. And that ship was built really, really quickly and became iconic. Who would have known?
As soon as he comes on set, everyone goes a bit silly.
It's always interesting to see, especially the hardened film crews, you know, around R2 and C-3PO, particularly R2, because R2 is R2, you know, he never changes. And film crews will always clamor to get their picture taken with him.
My daughter wants to marry him. She says she went to bed, she cried herself to sleep one night because she wasn't with R2-D2. And she wanted to marry him, and I love him, where is he? And she cried herself to sleep over a robot. But he's George's favorite actor, I believe.
I'm safe.
George always has this like a love-hate relationship with R2, it seems like.
No, I love R2. I wouldn't write him into all this if I didn't love him.
But I think he doesn't like working with him. And understandably so. I mean, in the first film that George, in the original Star Wars, the thing never worked.
If he's standing still and turning his head and whistling and stuff, he's perfect. But when we start having to move him around, that's when the fun starts, really. He's doing really well in this one, but he falls over and stuff a lot, or gets stuck on gratings because of the grooves in them or something that catch him out now and again. I don't personally want to marry him, but you can feel great affection for him. And I think it's a combination of his shape and everything, but his voice is high-pitched and whistly, and I don't know, there's some combination of it that really, really works.
I always believe like 70 to 90% of the character comes from the voice that they put in later by Ben Burt.
At one point, we talked about R2's personality, and we felt he was developing kind of as a toddler. He was sort of almost a baby. He could communicate, but he would make sounds which gave the emotional content of what he wanted to get across. Eventually, we found that we were making the sounds ourselves. We were kind of, George would beep and boop, and I might beep and boop back. So a few experiments led to the combination of using my voice doing baby talk, beeps and boops, with the electronic synthesizer. So R2 is sort of 50% machine and 50% organic.
It's a very interesting character to, you know, for what it is, and, you know, it's tin can. So seeing somebody like Ewan get excited about R2 is kind of fun. And he was particularly excited about working with R2 on his last day of filming.
Okay.
Well done.
It's very good.
He is a movie star, and he gets that respect when he comes on set.
There's gonna be a party for R2. Sam Jackson didn't get this.
Because he is a legend, you know.
being ready to graduate high school and seeing that first movie, Star Wars. And being in the theater and thinking, oh gosh, someday I want to work on a film like that, without any idea that I would be working on a film like that, that one. It was incredible. It was like, this doesn't happen, but it did. As we were just starting to get into the prequels, George also wanted to do the special edition to add in some of the things that George always wanted to do, but wasn't able to because the technology didn't exist. He wanted to replace a particular character that he felt wasn't working too well in the cantina scene with something that was much more interesting. I was given this character, and I decided to go the pachyderm route, in other words, an elephant-type creature. And obviously I couldn't do one with an extremely long trunk because there wouldn't be enough room in the frame, but I kind of went on a kind of a short-eared mastodon creature with a short trunk and some really interesting curled-up tusks. And some large eyes that were large enough to carry an expression. And I knew that this was kind of a sophisticated puppet rather than something that was in CG, which is great because it makes it even more real. You have the real lighting, you have real time, and it's even more, often even more real than digital. And so that's where Ketwal came to be. Ketwal got his name. If you reverse the lettering order, it's low tech. And it's not a fancy computer-generated image. It's a, he exists in real time. And so low-tech, but it works.
Colin Cantwell's original concept model for the Death Star, of course, is this. It is it's a very delicate ball about something like that. And of course, it's silver, and it has these little doodads. We made it much more mathematical, you know, rather than arbitrary pieces here and there. We eventually knew that it ruins the scale of things to make them shiny, you know, especially silver. It wouldn't look very good. So we definitely went to that aged off gray. It was just the most rudimentary object, those concept models. And do you know that they were used for with George to go to the studios to have something visual to talk about, to say, well, there'll be an X-Wing and it will have a fight, battle with this, and this will be the Death Star and all that kind of stuff. So to somehow convince studios that this is a reasonable idea, a reasonable project that he wants to do. For the most part, they were matte paintings. There was a matte painting of the Death Star for the first Star Wars, New Hope. But there was a half sphere about this big made that we painted that gray, off-white gray color, and then scratched through and had a stage light behind it. And that particular model was so funky, and I think someone dropped it at one time, it had a crack, and we threw it in the trash. And somebody, you know, went through our trash at nighttime, and eventually I think it's in a museum in Washington now.
The way we got into doing the holographic chess scene was there was some overflow work from England for the cantina scene. George wanted to open it up to more alien-like characters. And so while we were building the stuff, George would stop by once a week and check out the progress. And during one of his visits, he saw some stop-motion puppets that we had just sitting on a shelf. And George was like a big fan of the Ray Harryhausen movies and knew that the potential for doing the stuff, you know, was really terrific if you could get it working. And we were like these guys that we were looking for a job that could do that kind of stuff. So George hired John Berg and myself to do this chess piece. There's a little character that beep, 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 kind of jumps in like a kangaroo, and another thing that comes up and picks it up and throws it on the ground. And the big thing was this character that I had that had a skeleton in it, and the rest are very, very simple and very rudimentary. And we probably banged them out in like 2 or 3 days and went over to ILM, and Dennis set up the shot. And I think we shot all of the takes in just a matter of 2 days. When you're doing stop motion work, you really want to, as much as possible, be cut off from like any distractions, because you're just trying to remember momentums and moving like 20 things at the same time. And is this going forward, this going back? So you're really concentrating really hard. But in the next room right over there, they were having their rap party. So it was yee-haw, sheesh, ha-ha, going on. That's, you know, I remember we just had like, trying, you know. That, so if there are any like pops in there, it was like, we were just, hey, could you guys keep it quiet?
You made a fair move. Screaming about it can't help you.
I don't have it. It's not wise to upset a Wookiee.
But, sir, nobody worries about upsetting a droid.
It's because a droid don't pull people's arms out of their sockets when they lose. Wookiees are known to do that.
I see your point, sir. I suggest a new strategy, R2. Let the Wookiee win. I think we took a wrong turn.
In Colin Cantwell's original concept model, of course, it has the long nose, just like the real X-Wing had. But we were also amused that the body of that is actually a dragster body. That's what makes that long nose, you know. his models were kind of lightweight, not as swarthy, not as strong-looking. So we took some of the ideas, which I think was originally Ralph McQuarrie's idea. He had a small X-wing in a painting. And George had this idea of a used universe. I remember the idea came down from him. And he didn't want anything too slick or too well-painted. Or it also needed to look aged. And also boilerplate technology. Everything had to look like it had been riveted together, assembled, rather than just a slick mono shape. And that was one of the guiding principles for our models. Yeah, we changed quite a bit from the concepts for the X-Wing. And one of the reasons was to make it look stronger, but also it had to contain motors for the ship to go into an X. Our X-Wing was probably about that long from nose to tail. And we carved it out of wood. A wooden pattern. We didn't always do that, but that particular case we did. But then it also had a lot of tank parts, and all along the backside where the engine is and the back end and that kind of thing was really well and completely detailed. But the X-Wing, you know, became a very, very important model. You know, there's probably more shots of close-ups and, you know, actors in X-Wings, because they could have some personality, you know. Darth Vader had personality, we could call it that, but all the pilots that were with him, you know, they were just dark shapes, you know. But so there was a lot of emphasis on the X-Wings.
They could use a good pilot like you. You're turning your back on them.
What good's the reward if you ain't around to use it? Besides, attacking that battle station ain't my idea of courage. It's more like suicide.
In Colin Cantwell's original concept model, of course, it has the long nose, just like the real X-Wing had. But we were also amused that the body of that is actually a dragster body. That's what makes that long nose, you know. His models were kind of lightweight, not as swarthy, not as strong-looking. So we took some of the ideas, which I think was originally Ralph McQuarrie's idea. He had a small X-Wing in a painting. And George had this idea of a used universe. I remember the idea came down from him, and he didn't want anything too slick or too well painted, or it also needed to look aged, and also boilerplate technology. Everything had to look like it had been riveted together, assembled, rather than just a slick mono shape. And that was one of the guiding principles for our models. Yeah, we changed quite a bit from the concepts for the X-Wing. And one of the reasons was to make it look stronger, but also it had to contain motors for the ship to go into an X. Our X-Wing was probably about that long from nose to tail, and we carved it out of wood, a wooden pattern. We didn't always do that, but that particular case we did. But then it also had a lot of tank parts, and all along the backside where the engine is and the back end and that kind of thing, it was really well and completely detailed. But the X-Wing, you know, became a very, very important model. You know, there's probably more shots of close-ups and, you know, actors in X-Wings, because they could have some personality, you know. Darth Vader had personality, we could call it that, but all the pilots that were with him, you know, they were just dark shapes, you know. But so there was a lot of emphasis on the X-Wings.
They could use a good pilot like you. You're turning your back on them.
What good's the reward if you ain't around to use it? Besides, attacking that battle station ain't my idea of courage. It's more like suicide.
The Y-Wing was featured in some of Ralph McQuarrie's early concept illustrations. Kind of harkens back to the P-38, you know, the two fuselage fighter plane of World War II. Colin Cantwell did the concepts to get the idea across of the basic look of and feel of all the different fighters and ships. I think the Y-Wing particularly is an interesting idea, an interesting ship. It reminded me a little bit of a 57 Thunderbird. It had kind of a sleekness to it. As we worked on it and added details to it, it took on more of a kind of a cobbled together hot rod look. We had a lot of freedom in interpreting the concept models, and a lot of the time the direction that they took was determined more by the kind of parts that we could find to build them. Like, I remember the front of the rocket engine was actually a legs container. I don't know if people are familiar with that, but that was a plastic container for a hose that we could just get at a drugstore. All the smaller fighter models had to be produced and molded molded in foam to make explosion versions of them. That's a bit more difficult and time-consuming to make sure that every detail that's put on there could be pulled out of a mold. One of my most memorable moments of making the models in Star Wars was one day we stretched a wire from the warehouse to a tree that was in the parking lot, and we attached a Y-wing to that wire and put a rocket motor in one of the rocket sides and ignited it, and it took off and flew across the parking lot in about a half a second, and with smoke trailing behind it, and it had it was curving, and it was better than anything that ended up in the film. It was really exciting, and it hit the tree and just exploded into 100 pieces, and it was really a fun moment. Y-Wing was featured in some of Ralph McQuarrie's early concept illustrations. Kind of harkens back to the P-38, you know, the two fuselage fighter plane of World War II. Colin Cantwell did the concepts to get the idea across of the basic look of and feel of all the different fighters and ships. I think the Y-Wing particularly is an interesting idea, an interesting ship. It reminded me a little bit of a 57 Thunderbird. It had kind of a sleekness to it. As we worked on it and added details to it, it took on more of a kind of a cobbled together hot rod look. We had a lot of freedom in interpreting the concept models, and a lot of the time the direction that they took was determined more by the kind of parts that we could find to build them. Like, I remember the front of the rocket engine was actually a legs container. I don't know if people are familiar with that, but that was a plastic container for a hose that we could just get at a drugstore. All the smaller fighter models had to be produced and molded molded in foam to make explosion versions of them. That's a bit more difficult and time-consuming to make sure that every detail that's put on there could be pulled out of a mold. One of my memorable moments of making the models in Star Wars was one day we stretched a wire from the warehouse to a tree that was in the parking lot, and we attached a Y-Wing to that wire and put a rocket motor in one of the rocket sides and ignited it, and it took off and flew across the parking lot in about a half a second, and with smoke trailing behind it, and it had a curve, it was curving, and it was, you know, better than anything that ended up in the film. It was really exciting, and it hit the tree and just exploded into 100 pieces, and it was really a fun moment.
Here they come. The concept for the TIE fighter is much more spindly. You can see that little round shape has no real detail on it, just a little ball, and the rods and the wings are very lightweight and thin. You know, in some ways it's more like a glider compared to a fighter pilot plane, that kind of thing. And we definitely had to head that direction with it. It needed to look not like a lightweight pleasure ship, but a heavyweight battleship. The final TIE fighters also changed radically for color. The bad guys all had this kind of a dark military blue battleship color, and the good guys were a little bit lighter value. We certainly did, on the TIE fighter, we did kit bashing, but there's so many shapes. The multi-spoke thing on the wheel, the ball that isn't totally a ball that goes off into a more of a hexagonal side pieces. All of those had to be carved individually. They weren't kitbashed. The kitbashing part of it is the little tiny little details. And, you know, we knew that since you had a key light all of the sun, it would create all these little hard shapes, hard little lines and everything on the shadows. They do have a certain amount of bashed kits in there, but the bulk of it is carved in wood or plastic and then molded.
Here they come.
The concept for the TIE fighter is much more spindly. You can see that little round shape has no real detail on it, just a little ball, and the rods and the wings are very lightweight and thin. You know, in some ways it's more like a glider compared to a fighter pilot plane, that kind of thing. And we definitely had to head that direction with it. It needed to look not like a lightweight pleasure ship, but a heavyweight battleship. The final TIE fighters also changed radically for color. The bad guys all had this kind of a dark military blue battleship color, and the good guys were a little bit lighter value. We certainly did, on the TIE fighter, we did kit bashing, but there's so many shapes. The multi-spoke thing on the wheel, the ball that isn't totally a ball that goes off into a more of a hexagonal side pieces. All of those had to be carved individually. They weren't kitbashed. The kitbashing part of it is the little tiny little details. And, you know, we knew that since you had a key light all of the sun, it would create all these little hard shapes, hard little lines and everything on the shadows. They do have a certain amount of bashed kits in there, but the bulk of it is carved in wood or plastic and then molded.
Stay in attack formation.
At the very beginning, there wasn't, we didn't think like there'll be a special TIE fighter for Darth Vader, but they knew they set them out in space and they're flying around. Well, who's who? You know, what do you put a big sign on it that says this is Darth Vader's ship, or, you know, how do you do that? Because even when you go in for a close-up on the face, and then when you go to a faraway shot, if all the TIE fighters are exactly the same, you know, which one is he? You can definitely tell Darth Vader's ship because it doesn't have those big long wings up the side. You know, it's more condensed. The cockpit is exactly the same, or at least almost exactly the same. But the wings were just made different, so you definitely knew which ship Darth Vader was in when it appeared on the screen. Curiously enough, there was even a drawing that was called a double cockpit TIE fighter that was similar to Darth's. And we nicknamed that the double chili TIE because there was a place you could get chili dogs near where we worked. And, you know, you could get a double chili TIE too, which is more chili on top of the hot dog. So it was probably left over from George saying, well, let's make the Millennium Falcon like a hamburger, you know. So now we had a chili dog model too. Doing the Death Star surface, the laser tower that was a part of the concept art that Joe Johnston and Ralph McQuarrie were doing, we created them in a couple of different sizes, the small size and the bigger size. But when you want to do a close-up, you can't close in on a model that's this big and have it fill up the full screen. And that's what, when we build the big model, you get in close to that laser tower. And I think Paul Houston was the one who did that particular model.
I worked on the storyboards for the initial bidding phase of the Star Wars effects. So I had drawn a lot of different cannons and trenches and the ships and stuff like that. So I had an idea in my mind of what it should look like. We didn't use a lot of reference for building these things. It was, I think, most of the model makers for Star Wars considered that there's a kind of a mechanical aesthetic that we all appreciated and tried to put into the models, that a certain arrangement of exhaust pipes look cool. A large barrel with cooling rods and ammo packets can just be arranged in a way that sculpturally and aesthetically looks interesting and fun. This shot was the first shot that was completed by ILM. We printed out a big picture and framed it, and everybody signed it and gave it to George, and it said, at the bottom it said, our first shot. That was at the point where we'd spent some millions of dollars to get the visual effects facility up and running. It was kind of an exciting first moment.